Hello, happy site owners. Mayanna here with the Blog A Tips Tuesday video recap for May 16th, 2017. We've got some late breaking news that didn't make it into the original post or podcast. And so let's jump on over and have a look at what's in it. So I'm going to scroll down just a little bit and we're going to have a little peek here at what's in Tips Tuesday this week. I want to send a shout out and thank you to John Overall of the WP, he calls it WP, Plugins A to Z podcast and his post. You know, John and his co-host have a fantastic podcast. They take plugins and actually test them out and give them ratings, and it's a great way to find out about new plugins and maybe some old ones revisited. Plus, he has posts with roundup of news that's new, plus some that's really good that you might have missed, and he has been including my post in there as well. And thank you so much, John. I do appreciate that. And to everybody who shares my post, I see you and appreciate you. Thank you so much. Well, I'm still catching up from, and let me make this just a hair bigger if I can so you can see at least the titles of what we're covering here. I'm still playing catch up. You know, a couple of weeks ago, my internet was down for 3 days. And then I just got caught up from that, and then my internet went out again for a day and a half, and I'm just now starting to get caught up from that. And, you know, I can't stand that. I ended up changing providers over it because I've got to have my internet, you know. And the main thing that I go over here in Tips Tuesday is having a contingency plan for things like that because, you know, not having internet is more than an inconvenience for me. Now, if anything happens to me, I'm covered. I've got that part of my contingency plan well covered for everything, right? And not only POAs for the person to take care of my estate and everything, but also the techie people to help her because she's not a tech. And the techie people who can help her and take care of my business online and that kind of thing. But while I was in Nashville, I had a contingency plan for having extended power or internet outages. I don't have that in my new place. And you're not going to find me at Mickey D's or a coffee shop on free Wi-Fi, you know, because I'm logging in to client sites and things. I need secure Wi-Fi for that. So I'm working on setting up a contingency plan for that thing. And I would encourage you, I know it's something we just keep putting on the back burner, but I would strongly encourage you to set yours up as well. And make sure somebody knows how to get to all of your accounts, what all of your accounts are. I mean, you could spend 10 or 15 minutes a day making a nice list for them and that kind of thing with all the passwords and just to let them know what all of the accounts are. You know, that would be a major help to somebody in your absence. So try to put that on your burner, to, you know, on your to-do list to get that done. Also, in SEO tips, I hope you got to see my post from yesterday. I hope you did get to see any of my posts. Let me back up. Not only was I out of internet or whatever it looks like, my cron job on my host is having a problem, and my last two posts didn't publish on time. You know, they were scheduled. And I meant to check it last night, but I forgot before I went to bed. So anyway, hopefully it's fixed now, and we'll see, but some of you did not get your RSS to email. You're running kind of a day behind, and tomorrow you should get Tips Tuesday, so I'm sorry for that, but I guess we'll see on the next post, huh? Guys, I'm a site owner, too. I have the same stuff y'all do, you know, that things break or don't work or something happens or whatever. I'm in the same boat, but I hope you did get to see my post from Monday. Google has a powerful integration that they actually came out with several months ago, and I just now really got into testing it and looking at it, and it pulls some of your data from Google Search Console into analytics, and Google Search Console basically has two kinds of data in it, and you'll want to go read my post for what those are, and half of it brought in, the kind that you can really use in analytics, and combine the things together so you can see what the queries were that people typed in, where they found your stuff, where it showed up in SERPs. And man, is that helpful like crazy. And I know a lot of you, especially you savvy marketers, look at your analytics like a hawk, right? But you don't always go to Search Console. So there's a ton of information about how you're doing in search, and it will help you improve your SEO. And now it's in your analytics, so it makes it a lot easier to see. And you can track your traffic all the way through. Now, you can't track it from the query all the way through your site. It's not a one-to-one correlation like that. But there are tons of insights in there. I've been poring over mine like crazy because of it. And then Google has a live stream coming up. They're doing this more and more. I'm glad to see them jump on the live stream bandwagon with more information. And they have a free webinar coming up. You do need to register for it, though. And it's about Google Ads, Analytics, and DoubleClick. So be sure to check on that. It's May 23rd. So make sure that you see about that. And then in WordPress tips, pardon me, this didn't make it into the original post or podcast because it didn't happen until this afternoon. But WordPress 4.5.7 is rolling out. And I've listed here all the security fixes. I'm going to jump over to the actual site so you can see it too. And I know that's really little, but there were 6 security fixes in this. And a couple of them were kind of big. The XML RPC API is having issues. And there are a couple of cross-site scripting issues too that were in 4.7.4. Now this will be an auto update, so you don't have to do anything unless, of course, you turn those off, and I hope you didn't. And you probably had to hard code that, so don't worry about it if you don't know what I'm talking about. There were also 3 maintenance bug scripts in there too, so hopefully that's going to keep us all nice and safe. Now WordPress 4.8, the beta release, is already out. It came out on May 12th. So I've been talking all day to clients. My voice is about gone. So the beta came out on the 12th. We're expecting the first release candidate on the 25th, and then the final release candidate June 8th, I think it is. And so we've got, here's the thing, Matt Mullenweg is trying to keep this train running. He's pushing it through, but they tried to cram a lot of stuff into this 5-week release cycle, and some of the devs are very concerned about that, meaning we need to be very concerned about that too. And Matt said, look, put in there whatever's ready, whatever's not, just skip it, leave it out, we'll put it in the next release. So because of that, we are going to hesitate just a little bit on updating until they shake the bugs out of this one too, right? But it's got some really neat things in it, like new widgets. Now, I am not going to make a sneak peek video for you until that release candidate comes out, because they're not sure what's going to be in this thing or not. So I've gotten burned making those things too early, because I show you things that don't end up in the final version. So it'll be closer to first week in June before we see that. But I'm really excited. I've been kind of playing with some of these new widgets and whatever, and they're kind of fun. So I'm excited about showing those to you here pretty soon. So just to know that it's not just a bunch of techie stuff. There's some actually fun things in there for us as well. And WordPress had their first JavaScript chat. Now, this is a big deal, guys. I mean, it's a really big deal, because this is a programming language we're moving to for WordPress. Right now it's all PHP, so your plugins, so your themes. This is a huge milestone. And in their second meeting, they just had the first meeting to go over things. In the second meeting, they got a really good clue what it's going to take to do all this, and they're looking at climbing a mountain. This is going to take way longer than I think anybody thought about, but hey, they're starting. And according to Matt, this is the way forward. The problem is, we don't have as many devs who are experienced with JavaScript as we do PHP, so everybody's got to get up to speed. And not just, look, you can go to school all day long, but this kind of stuff has little to do with the real world. You know, I mean, it's going to take experienced devs to really push this forward, and there are just not that many of them in WordPress that know JavaScript. I know when Matt talked about this, he announced it a year ago, the coding schools started filling up like crazy for folks wanting to learn JavaScript. Now, some plugin developers are already ahead of the curve on this, and they're already designing their plugins in JavaScript instead of PHP. So I think Food Gallery, I think I read one on them. There are probably a few others, but they rebuilt one of their plugins from the ground up on JavaScript, and that was before Matt even announced it. So they were already, I think, seeing which way the wind was blowing at that point and decided that was a good thing to do. I think we're going to see more and more of that as plugin developers have to revamp for PHP 7 and this REST API. And they may just decide to rebuild the whole thing. I think we're also coming to a crisis point, and I didn't put this in Tips Tuesday, but I'll say it here. I think we're coming to a crisis point with plugins. Over the half of the ones, there's like 40,000 in the free repository. Over half of them haven't been updated in over 2 years, and they're not going to. They're going to be abandoned at this point. And I think the days are over with a lot of devs putting out a bunch of free plugins anyway. They may do a freemium version, but it's not sustainable. WordPress, everything changes too fast. It's the same problem that I'm having with my business and other people are in this industry. We're losing our shirts because things are just moving so fast. And I am pivoting my whole business. I've been doing this now for, what, 4, 5, 6 months? Now, pivoting my business, and it's going to take all year to pivot over to what it is, but you're already starting to see a glimpse with that, with the workshops and those sorts of one-off things, instead of these big behemoth video libraries that are going to get dated. It's moving that fast. Sweeping changes coming. I think plugin and theme developers are getting a hint at this too. And you know, new devs code these things up to cut their teeth and to prove themselves and to put it out there in the world and see how it does and whatever. It's unsustainable. It has been for years. And so that's why we've got so many plugins that are abandoned, right? And we're coming to a crisis point with that. And as we move into JavaScript, it's going to get worse and worse and worse and worse as we go. So we've got this major transition period. And I think we're going to move into more paid plugins. I think less of them are going to be free. That's my guess. But I can't see how we can sustain it otherwise. I know that the open source community likes to make a lot of things for free, but hey, everybody's got to eat, right? So, you know, look for more changes. In other words, just look for another year or two of major changes with WordPress. One of the other things that I'm delighted to let you know about, you know, I had a private conversation with Matt Mullenweg about his vision. And there were some things that I just couldn't reveal because I'm not going to steal their thunder. You know, things he told me privately, don't let it out. Don't let the cat out of the bag until it actually happens and let them announce it first. Well, they did that. And Jetpack Premium, the premium version that you had to pay for, is now available when you host on Pressable. Now, if you watched my video on the future of WordPress site ownership, and I hope you have now. If you haven't, it's been made public. It's got a lot of really critical information about all these changes we're going through. I talked about Pressable, and I talked about some of the things I could tell you that Matt told me and what we discussed. And Pressable, what makes it different, it's got this dome of protection over it. It's the same one that WordPress.com has on it. You don't hear about any problems over there. So if you're on Pressable, it's okay to use Jetpack there. I don't advocate it for self-hosted sites on hosts where you don't have this dome of protection on there. It opens up XML RPC. I still say that's a big no-no for that, but it's okay if you're on Pressable. I think, as a matter of fact, I talked to a client today. I told him, I think self-hosted WordPress is not the way for you to go, and if it is, consider coming off SiteGround, which is a fabulous host, but consider getting on something that's managed for you, and maybe consider Pressable or some other way of going with this, because he just wants a brochure site. He's not looking to get a lot of business. All this upkeep and cost and whatever, I don't think it's the way to go. So if you do have just an online brochure site or whatever, really think about Pressable. And hopefully by this summer, I'm going to have some tutorials for you on that. I think it's a good idea for certain kinds of sites. Let me put it that way. The next thing is, oh, you got to see this. There's a photo gallery it's made by Food. Let me just jump over there and show it to you because I like Food plugins. I like these guys. I like everything about them. And for all the folks who do crafty, foodie, lifestyle blogging, got all these tons of pictures, it is killing your page load speed. It's just killing it. And honest to God, nobody wants to see 8 pictures of the same thing. If you're baking a pie, give me 8 different pictures of making it. Don't give me 1 or 2 before shots and then 10 of the same pie just at different angles already baked. It's not photojournalism. It doesn't do anybody any good, and they're all pretty, and you've taken 40 shots, and you want to use as many as you can. Honest to God, it doesn't do anything for you. So this is a really neat way to do the step-by-step thing. Takes up one little spot in here, doesn't kill your page load speed, and they're making lemonade here, and you can see, I don't know if y'all can see this. Let me blow this up a little bit so maybe you can see it. If I'm not blocking it with my own happy head in there, it's got a next and a previous button in it. And so it's really nice. And either think about doing something like this or maybe pagination like it does in a magazine. You see this on WebMD and other places where they have this much of the article and then you have to hit next to get the next page and they split it across 10 pages, which makes everybody nutty too, but you don't have to do that much of it. But really start thinking about that for your page load speed. People get to see more ads this way. And two, so it might be a good idea for you to think about a gallery like this, at least for some of your images. Definitely not all of them, but seriously consider this nice gallery plugin from Foo. And it does a lot of neat things, too. So I just like Foo. Pardon me. Insight tips. Oh, the nice folks over, who was it that did this? John Hughes wrote it, but it's over at Torque. And he wrote a post on, John Hughes did, on the three compelling reasons you should make the switch to PHP 7 for WordPress. And he's got a lot, if you really want to know what all this hoo-ha is about, me jumping up and down talking about it, whatever, this is a really good post to read about what PHP 7 is, why we need to switch to it, and that kind of thing. Now, on down through here, he does have, he gives you the whole history and stuff behind it, but he does talk a little bit about WP Engine in here as well that made this nice plug-in for PHP 7 compatibility check. It doesn't really talk about it very much. If you need hand-holding for this a little bit, I've got a link here for my post that hands holds you through checking it and what to do. Now, get in on this, guys. I'm running this seriously old plug-in challenge. I'm going to jump over to it right quick for the whole month of May. And you want to get in on this as soon as you can, because once we're kind of done with it, I'm going to be leaving it alone. So don't wait. You know, let us know what plugins are showing up for you old. And down here at the bottom, I've got the link for you about how to run the check, and then what else to check about your old plugins. And then way down here at the bottom, we've got our list of the plugins that people are turning in that are really old, maybe things with a green X on them, are the recommended vetted plugins for me for you to switch over to. Some of them we haven't found yet. It's just if I hadn't gotten kicked off the internet for a few days, I would have looked into these a little bit more. So it really helps all of us if we're a village and get in on this together and report these things. So you can see all the people, nice folks who've been leaving comments here on the blog. Just leave them right there. It's as easy as that. Tell us what you found, if you found any replacements for them, and we'll check into that too. And then in this, at the end of this, toward the end of the month, the 25th, which is, you know, about 9 days away, just a little over a week, we're going to have a town hall meeting about it and discuss all this about switching up and what it means for you. And we can do some more Q&A at that time too. So do get in on this Seriously Plug-In Challenge. Hey, it's free. It's village help. It's crowdsource help in here for this. And you get some time with me if you've got questions. Also, there is no such thing is too many examples of a great about page, because, you know, it is just literally one of the most important pages on your site. And over here on Eileen, my friend, let me get up here where you can see that, my friend Eileen Smith, on her basic blog tips, one of my favorite bloggers, Ann Smarty, has a nice post here about how to create an effective about me page. And she's got all the reasons, but look at this. This is what sets us apart. She's got all kinds of tools here for you that you're just not going to find many listings like this on the about me page. Some tools that are great for you to check out even beyond writing your about me page. So check out those tools. But then she's got some mad examples in here for you. And no matter what kind of about me page you need, what your audience is like, what your style is, you know, these examples are going to give you some ideas and open you up. So they're really kind of cover a broad spectrum, put it that way. In webmaster tips, I was really happy to see this post over on Moz about going beyond Google's PageSpeed Insights. And honestly, I think they make the case for why I don't put too much weight into those testing things. You really ought to read the post for yourself. If you're using Google PageSpeed Insights and Pingdom to evaluate your site, you're in the dark, because they're not accurate. They don't tell you a lot of stuff. I mean, I include them in site audits just to show how in the dark you are and how inaccurate they are, because all of my other testers, plus all of the checks that I do at the host and on the site, we've already put the puzzle together. We already know what all the problems are. And I put these others in there just to show you what you don't know because of those. And so I think they make the case for this. As a matter of fact, if I see anybody come to me and say, can you help me get my Google PageSpeed score up, I'm going to send them this post and say, let them know why this is not the definitive end-all be-all about worrying about that score. One of the reasons, too, if you're just wondering, I mean, I don't just blow them off because it is important what Google thinks, but one of the heavy weighted scores to the tune of 15 to 20 points is whether you have AMP on your site or not. Most of us don't. Most of us can't make use of it, but they're penalizing everybody 15, 20 points. Another 15 or 20 pointer is because they want you to use lossless images, is what I heard. I mean, all of a sudden the score has just plummeted, and I wondered why, and heard somebody say they want you to use lossless images. Well, that's just as backwards as it can be. You definitely want to use lossy. Now, as backwards as that sounds, you do want to use lossy, and they're going to look better and whatever, but Google's penalizing people for things that most of us aren't even going to use. So trying to get 100 score in that anyway is probably not what your ultimate goal is anyhow. I mean, yeah, you can do it, but you're going to have to strip your moneymakers out or do things like AMP that are just convoluted and make you have to change how you do your content and blah, blah, blah. So I think if you're still relying on Google PageSpeed Insights for any reason, go read this post on Moz. And I think you'll get an idea of why I don't rely on it much. And then A2 Hosting has a nice post on what reseller hosting is and how you can take advantage of it. If you are a designer, you really need to read this. Or even, and yeah, I put it in Webmaster Tips, but if you're a site owner with multiple sites, it would be a really good idea for you to read this because you don't want to have all of your sites on one cPanel. It's a security and a performance risk, but mainly a security issue. You want to have them in each in their own cPanel, and what's called a reseller account or a WHM account allows you to do that. I'm on one, and I don't resell, nor do I advocate reselling, nor do I advocate that site owners buy their hosting from a reseller. You want to go directly to the host and get your own account so you can have direct support, because that designer may fall off the planet, and then where are you? You know, so, and don't think the host is going to give you access. So I think this is a really good post from A2 to tell you about what reseller hosting is. And of course, it's geared to people who are actually reselling, but it's a really good idea for a lot of multiple site owners. You know, if you've got multiple sites, it's a great idea. Designers, it lets you set up a sandbox there until you get paid. You're not putting it on your client site where they could just off and run, because unfortunately, you know, people talk about how bad designers are and developers and how much they got ripped off. Yeah, clients rip them off too. You know, that goes both ways, big time, right? So it secures the site. It makes sure that the security is all set up, that you can keep hands out while you're doing certain things, that the client can't get in there and poke around when you don't want them to. You can control access to it. It's a really good idea. Plus, because it's in its own cPanel, when you get ready to migrate, you could actually ask their hosting company to migrate it just like it would from any other host. It's in a cPanel, and it's a cPanel migration. The only thing is about changing over the domain name. So you may want to stick with your own migration process, whatever it is you do. But you could do that. I've had to do it on occasion when the site was kind of really big in the sandbox. So do go read up on that. Plus, if you get any kind of hosting, you're thinking about reseller, A2 is the only one that has reseller hosting on shared. You do not have to get a very expensive VPS account. That's what I'm on. I don't have the traffic to warrant VPS, right? And we're talking about a difference of about $400 a year. So, I mean, it ain't pennies, you know what I'm saying? And it's really affordable for designers and people who have multiple sites. So that may be a good thing for you. And if you do, please use my affiliate link, because that supports all this free information that I give out on BlogAid, like this Tips Tuesday. So that's what's in the news this week. And I'm going to go over, I'm streaming live on Facebook. If you're watching this on YouTube, then I am streaming live over on Facebook. Please do follow the BlogAid Facebook page over there so you get notified when I stream live. And I'm going to jump in and answer some questions and comments from that. And I'll see you online.